the Lord has made. Indeed, the Bible says that this is the day that the Lord has made, that you will rejoice and be glad in it. Well, we have lined up a beautiful set of songs that we're going to use to praise God. So wherever you are, I'd like to welcome you to lean in and let's enjoy the presence of God together. Come on, let's go.
Yeah.
Come on, just move from left to right like this.
Desire of our
heart, that in His name will be glorified, that His name will be praised forever and ever and ever. Now, I don't know about you, but I love calling the name of the Lord. The Bible says that those who call upon the Lord are like Mount Zion. The Bible says that they shall mount up on wings like eagles. Now, I want to encourage you this morning, wherever you are, whatever situation you are in, please call on the name of the Lord and see how He performs miracles in your life. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. We love you, Lord. We've come to worship you, Lord. There's no other God like you. You reign forever. We love calling your name. In your name, there's power, there's victory. And yes, you conquer death because you live, we live today. No other God can be called our Father. No other God can be called our friend. No other God can be called Redeemer. No other God is coming back again. And how we love your name, Jesus, you're the beautiful one. We love your name. Hey! And how we love your name, Jesus, you're the beautiful one. Yes, Lord, we love your name. Be magnified, Jehovah. You reign forever, Lord. Hey! Hallelujah! Come on, let's sing it together. No other God,
no other God can be called our Father. No other God can be called a friend. No other God can God's coming back again.
See how we love your name. Oh,
how we love your name, Jesus. You're the beautiful one. We love your name.
How we love your name.
How we love your name, Jesus. You're the beautiful one. Your name.
to the righteous one. Lord, our prayer is that you shall find places in our lives to be glorified. Our desire is that you shall make our lives literally a podium for you to show off your glory. How we love your name, Jesus. There is no other God like you. In Jesus' name we have worshipped, and everybody say amen. Amen and amen and amen. Well, don't go nowhere. Even if it's your first time here, we still have so much lined up for you. You are not a stranger. You are in a place where we love people and we love God. So please tune in and stay on and get ministered to. And may God bless you. In Jesus' name, amen.
You would not exist. Your purpose would not be. The things that God created you for would not come to pass if not for those two parents. Because he was more interested in creating you than he was in their parenting skills. You must train your children to differentiate between the person and the position. There are times I don't like the person. I don't agree with the person. I don't feel this person. But they have a position of respect. When people dishonor the leaders in their lives, they become dishonored.
We come from normal families. Too normal, if I may say. Single families. Not the social unit kind of family, but the individualistic one. And definitely not the religious in outlook family, but the secular in attitude. We come from normal families. Too normal, if I may say. Marriage can be broken any minute. It has become a civil contract rather than a religious sacrament. We come from normal families, too normal, if I may say. Families with parenting issues, pressure from work or school, unemployment, and financial problems. We come from normal families, families with disabilities or illnesses, death, drugs, and alcohol. We come from normal families with gambling addictions and domestic violence. Sometimes when we struggle to cope with our pain and frustrations, we project them to other family members and friends. We come from normal families with heavy thoughts that weigh us down, negative voices in our heads that make us numb, make us doubt, make us frown, negative.
That's a way, way. Umona hafi daktari kwa hii familia. Tangu lini sisi tukafika university. Mapenda kuota sana. Even your father couldn't stand you and left, so sit down. Be humble. Stop wasting tears on that person you call mom. She'll never understand you. Hey, focus. Stop trying to run away from me. I am you. And you are me. I suffer. You suffer. We're in this together. I am your thoughts, for crying out loud.
Just shut up. Shut up. I can't take any more of your lies. You've taken enough already. I won't allow myself to be manipulated by you. Get out of my head. I come from a normal family. Too normal. But I'm gonna build a healthy family. I forgive myself, broken and bruised. We forgive ourselves, exhausted and abused. We'll work on rebuilding the good old times for better marriages. We'll appreciate the good in society and not just focus on the negatives. We forgive ourselves. We'll let go of family baggages that have killed the joy in our lives. We forgive ourselves. We won't lose heart.
We'll choose courage over fear and speak blessings over here. We'll work together to solve problems and avoid blame. We'll do away with the grasshopper mentality and conquer every mountain in front of us. We'll fight any giant we face because victory is ours in the Lord. We'll be the healthy families that God called us out to be, and we know it's not gonna be easy. We'll get tired along the way, but we'll keep going. We'll fight for each other because that's what family does. Not by might, but by grace.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening from wherever you're watching us from. Welcome to Mavuno Church. My name is Pastor Anthony, one of the pastors here at Mavuno Church. Today we want to continue with our series, Family Matters. And you know, as we have been going through this series, we have been learning, you know, as to how our families affect who we become. We have been identifying things in our families that might actually hinder us from becoming all that we were created to be. And so today we continue with our next sermon when it comes to family matters. You know, I've been a pastor for some time now. And, you know, almost every day or every week, I get to pray for families. And one of the things we pray is, you know, breaking generational curses, breaking spiritual bondages. But I came to realize not every one of us understands what these generational curses are, what these spiritual bondages are. And so today, I'd like us to kind of just have a proper understanding or a proper perspective of what is these things that are called generational curses or spiritual bondages. Let me say this, God's people. Generational curses and spiritual bondages are those negative patterns or consequences that are passed on to individuals because of the words, because of the sinful actions of the people in authority over them. These are negative patterns. These are consequences because of sinful actions, because of sinful words, you know, committed, by people in authority over them. These are sinful actions performed by an ancestor, or negative words spoken by someone in authority. And this is what happens. Because of those negative words, because of those sinful actions, they get to open a door. They get to open a door that gives an enemy, the enemy, the devil, the right to frustrate future generations. You know, the moment you see the word generational, it speaks about something that is perpetuated from one generation to another. I have seen many families where they say, in my generation, you know, I can see a pattern of entrepreneurship. In my generation, I see a pattern of leadership, of politicians, or maybe of pastors. The same way on the opposite, there are some things that are perpetuated in a generation, from one generation to another. But this time, we are talking about bondages, we are talking about curses, we are talking about negative patterns that you can actually see in a family. There are five things the Bible talks about, you know, that attract curses. These are things, if someone in a family, someone in authority commits these sins, it opens a door for the enemy to frustrate future generations. Number one, occultism. Occultism, in other words, witchcraft, divination, new age practices, sorcery. And I've seen in my experience, in my life as a pastor, where there is witchcraft, you see a lot of poverty, you see a lot of stagnation, you see a lot of marital failure or delays. Why? Because somebody in authority, a grandparent, you know, an ancestor, engaged in occultism, in witchcraft, in sorcery. And you can see that in Deuteronomy 18, verse 10 to 13. But also, another sin that attracts curses is sexual perversion. And you can see in Leviticus 23, this could be incest, this could be rape and all those kind of sexual perversion. They attract curses. And I've seen also where there is sexual perversion, marriages, teenage pregnancies, and all those manner of negative patterns. Oppression of the poor and helpless. That's another sin that attracts a curse. When someone commits or oppresses the poor and the helpless, that's a curse. And many a times in our nation, I see people oppressing the poor. I see people oppressing the helpless. And I'm like, don't you know that this particular sin can actually attract a curse that is going to destroy and limit and frustrate future generations? And that one you can see in Exodus 22, verse 25, or Exodus 23, verse 6 to 9. Another sin is idolatry, worshipping other idols or worshipping other gods, in Exodus chapter 20, verse 1 to 5. And the last one is the shedding of innocent blood. This one can attract a curse, can establish a spiritual bondage that actually frustrates, you know, future generation. Unless these things are dealt with, they continually frustrate. The devil maximizes on those doors and he frustrates the future generations. So because of these sinful actions, generational curses or bondages are established because of occultism, because of witchcraft, because of divination, because of polygamy, because of oppression of the poor and the helpless, because of idolatry, because of sexual perversion, because of shedding of innocent blood. We start seeing some patterns in a family. And I know maybe I'm speaking to somebody right now. There is a family. Men in your family don't go far. Men in your family never make it through school. They never find useful work. You know, all of them become alcoholics. I remember one time I went to pray for our family. Two brothers approached me and they said, you know, Pastor Anthony, we don't understand. You know, I don't see men in our family succeed. And the more we prayed and we were able to identify that there was a pattern, all the uncles in that family have not amounted to anything. The brothers, you can just see there is a sluggishness, a laziness, even with the boy child in school. There could be a generational bondage and a curse and a negative pattern. Something else I've seen in many families. Ladies getting children before marriage. It's like almost every lady, every woman will get a child before marriage. You look at the aunties. You look at everyone. Every woman gets children before marriage. Another one I've seen, it could be uncontrollable rage in a family. People have anger issues. They never talk, you know, to agree. Every meeting ends in a disarray. Every meeting ends so badly. Why? Because from the grandfather to the father, or to the grandmother, to the mother, everyone, to the children, to uncles, to aunties. Many people are struggling with rage. And the rage and the anger has caused marriages to end, have caused pain to children. Another thing I've seen is a pattern of stagnation, a pattern of lack of progress. It's like there is a line that has been drawn that nobody will ever go from this point. Nobody will ever go to the next level. There is a line that has been drawn that people stagnate. They never move forward. There is lack of progress. Another negative pattern will be in your family. There is a lot of miscarriage. There is a lot of miscarriages and barrenness. You know, as you can look at an auntie, a sister, someone you know who is so close, they have miscarried. You know, you see some people, you know, in different families in your clan or in your larger family, people struggle with barrenness. Or maybe to someone this morning, it's mental illness and depression. You can count more than 5, more than 6, more than 7 people that are struggling with depression, that are struggling with mental illness. And you're like, why? Why is it in every single family, in my uncles, in my aunties, in my father's side, in my mother's side, there is someone, one or two people who are struggling with mental illness and depression or chronic illnesses where diabetes is passed on from one generation to the next, high blood pressure, until some people have owned it and they said, oh, in our family, our diabetes, our high blood pressure. Then you're so used to these chronic diseases and illnesses, you have actually come to own them. But it's a generational curse, a generational spiritual bondage. Another thing I've seen is strife and sibling rivalry, rejection, failure and loss, untimely deaths and suicide. Siblings never talk to one another. There is this sibling rivalry, competition. There is this rejection. The other day, I was praying for a family, and there was this pattern of rejection. It's like all the women, wherever they go, whom they relate to, whom they are married to, it's like something just repulses. You know, they feel repulsed. They're rejected. And when they looked, they were like, oh, even my mom, it happened. Even my auntie, it happened. It's like there is a curse of rejection, or failure, or loss, or suicide. So the first question people ask me, what are generational curses and spiritual bondages? These are negative patterns that actually come to frustrate future generation because of a sinful word, because of a sinful action, a negative word or a sinful action that has been committed by someone in authority. I remember one time I went to pray for a family, and there was just this thing. Businesses were not working. And the moment we traced back, the grandfather at one time during the December holidays had actually spoken a word because he was expecting something big from his grandchildren. And they and he was so unhappy. And, you know, before he died, he had spoken a word and cursed the work of their hands. But you know what? We move on. Nobody took it seriously. But the old man died. And now after many years, businesses are not working. People are being, you know, fired from their workplaces, left, right, and center. Can I tell you this? And this is the truth. By the time I was praying for that family, none of that family had a job. None. It's like they were getting good jobs. After 2-3 months, they will be fired. Or just businesses will go down. Until we discovered and said there was a word that was spoken. Nobody really took it to heart. But apparently, it was someone in authority who spoke a negative word, and it came to be. And this family was in a generational curse. You know, there are people who have said this to me and said, but Pastor Anthony, how can generational curses and bondages affect me as a Christian? Jesus became a curse for me. How can this affect me? And this is what I say. They may not affect you. They may not have an eternal effect on you. You're going to go to heaven. You're going to see heaven. But listen, here on earth, the curses, the bondages, they're going to frustrate you. They will reduce the quality of life here on earth. Yes, you belong to God. Yes, you are assured of eternal salvation. But listen, you will experience frustration and difficulty because of generational curse or bondage that has never been broken. Listen to me, God's people. Yes, we have been given the victory over the cross, but we need to apply that victory into our realities. Let me give you a good example. Generational curses and bondages are more like limitations. They are limitations to a Jesus follower. To be limited, there are three things when it comes to a limitation or to be limited. Number one, you are restricted. Generational curses restrict you from becoming the woman, the man that God intends you to be. It restricts the businesses in your family. It restricts the marriages from becoming all that God intends for the marriages in your family. So there is the limitations. They restrict your family. But also, they resist they resist you. It's like almost generational curses and bondages. They resist you from moving forward. They are like, none of your family has ever experienced this blessing or has ever been at this level. And so they resist you. They push you back. Or they restrain you. Have you ever seen a chain over your body? It's like, yes, you can walk, but you are restrained. You know, a man or a woman under generational curses or bondages. This is a person who suffers in the midst of plenty. You are restricted. You are suffering in the midst of plenty. You cannot go beyond the limits the enemies have set for you. You know what you want, but somehow it's always difficult to get there. This is what generational curses do to people. They limit you. They restrict you. They resist you. They restrain you. It's like, yes, I'm born again. I go to keshas. I go to overnights. But there is this ceiling over me. When I look, you know, to my left, to my right, there is something about the women in my family, the men in my family. Why? Because generational curses are limitations. They limit you. So the question is, how do you break these generational curses? I remember in my own family, from my dad's side, every uncle, cousin I knew was suffering from alcoholism. There was this alcoholism that had owned my dad's family. Everyone I knew was in alcoholism. Talk about sibling rivalry. You know, people will fight. And until I recognized that and I said, I cannot raise, I cannot grow, I cannot be the man that I need to be if I don't break the curses in my father's side. If I don't break the curses of the sibling rivalry that I see in my father's house. So how do you break this limitation of curses and bondages? There is a family that was chosen by God in the Bible, but they experienced the limitations of generational bondages. And this family is Jacob's. Jacob's family had issues. Talk about patterns of strife. Talk about favoritism. Talk about jealousy. Talk about fear. Talk about deceit. It started with his grandfather, Abraham. You know the story, how Abraham lied that Sarah was his sister so that now nobody will touch her. He lied. And then after many years again, in Genesis 26, Isaac does the same thing. He lies that his wife was his sister. Talk about like father, like son. But that was on his father's side. Let's go to the mama's side, Rebecca. Rebecca's side was even worse. Rebecca came from a family of expert deceivers. She loved her younger son more than Esau because Jacob used to stay indoors and loved to cook. She conspired with Jacob to con her own father so that he could get the inheritance from his big brother. That one resulted into strife between the brothers. You know what happened after that? You know, Jacob is sent off to Uncle Laban, you know, to go there and get a wife. But he finally meets the expert con. Talk about Uncle Laban. This guy was a con of the con. So Jacob, he had a desire to marry, you know, a beautiful woman called Rachel, only for the uncle to con him last minute and gave him rather the plain old sister Leah. And then he had to work for 7 years. But on top of that, when the time came, you know, when Jacob was working for Uncle Laban, Uncle Laban changes the contract 10 times. You're like, he met the con of the cons. And somehow, in Jacob's own family, let's talk about the competition that was happening between the two wives. Who is going to get more children for Jacob? Until one time, even Leah was willing to bribe the young sister, Rachel, so that she could sleep with her husband. What a competition. What a messed up family. But then now, We come to Genesis 32. I think Jacob was like, no, I cannot live like this. Something needs to change in my family. Something needs to change in my family. And so Genesis 32, from verse 22 to 30, the Bible says, that night Jacob got up and took his two wives, his two female servants, and his 11 sons, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. After he had sent them across the stream, he sent over all his possessions. So Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him till daybreak. When the man saw that he could not overpower him, he touched the socket of Jacob's hip, so that his hip was wrenched as he wrestled with the man. Then the man said, let me go, for it is daybreak. But Jacob replied, I will not let you go unless you bless me. This man asked him, what is your name? Jacob, he answered. Then the man said, your name will no longer be Jacob. Then your name will no longer be Jacob, but Israel, because you have struggled with God and with humans and have overcome. Jacob said, please tell me your name. But he replied, why do you ask my name? Then he blessed him there. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, it is because I saw God's face to face, and yet my life was spared. This is what God is calling us to do, God's people. For us to break the generational curses and the spiritual bondages. Someone today, you must be willing to wrestle with God and break that curse and break that bondage and say, no more limitations in my family. I shall not stand and watch a negative pattern being perpetuated from one generation to another. I refuse. Be like Jacob. Wrestle with God. Let him bless you. Let him change you. Let him change the trajectory of your family today. I don't know who I'm speaking to. God is saying to somebody, you have been watching and just playing it cool. But listen, if you don't break that curse, your children are going to be frustrated and limited with the same curse. If you don't break that spiritual bondage, your children's children might be frustrated and be limited with the same bondage. Today, God is saying, break that curse. Jacob wrestled with God. God asked him, what is your name? It's not like God did not know Jacob's name, but he wanted him to bring him to a point where he's going to recognize. And he said, my name is Jacob. Do you know what Jacob means? A deceiver, a supplanter. He was saying, I recognize the weakness. I recognize the bondage. And God said, now that you recognize the curse, the bondage in your family, I'm going to give you a new name. I'm going to call you Israel, the one who has prevailed with God, the one who struggles with God. And he said, no longer will you be called a deceiver, but an overcomer. No longer are you going to be limited. You shall be free from the bondages of your family. Listen to me, God's people. God can turn around your family. God can turn around your family. He can change your destiny. God is calling us to wrestle with him in prayer, to break the limitations of negative patterns in your family. Someone today needs to close the doors that have plagued your families by wrestling with God in prayer and fasting. Oh boy, didn't I wrestle with God to break the spirit of alcoholism in my family? Together with my siblings, we identified several curses, several negative patterns. And we said, guys, let's pray and fast. We broke alcoholism. We broke the spirit of polygamy. We broke poverty. We broke stagnation. Up to today, we are still praying. There are four things I need you to do to break, as you break the curses and bondages in prayer. Four things. Number one, recognize. Recognize the negative patterns. Recognize the roots in your life and in your family. Go to prayer. Ask the Lord, reveal to me some of these curses, some of these spiritual bondages in my family. The anger that I see is not normal. The marriage delays I see, it is not normal. The marriage failures I see, it is not normal. Something is wrong. How comes three of us, we have been fired, our businesses are not thriving? Recognize those patterns. Be aware of the generational issues in your family. Number two is to repent. Repent. Confess the ancestral sins. Twice in the book of Nehemiah, chapter 1 and 9, we see Nehemiah making a prayer of confession for the sin of the forefathers that brought about their exile. This is where you come and say, Father, I repent the sins of my forefathers. I have heard one of my grandfather was in witchcraft. I repent of his sins. My family has been involved with strife and sibling rivalry. I repent, oh God. This is the place you become a man or a woman who stands in the gap of your family and repent. The next one is release. Oh, through the blood of Jesus, you declare that your family has been released from every negative pattern, from the curse, from the bondages. You're confronting every negative pattern with God's promises. And so you recognize, you repent, but now you release, and you're gonna be releasing. You're gonna be releasing as we sing the song, break every chain. We shall be releasing your family from every curse and spiritual bondage. And the last one is replace. Some of you, you need to identify the places you need to replace the negative patterns with positive patterns. For example, maybe some of you, you are coming from a family that is so plagued by sibling rivalry. Maybe today God is saying, start teaching about love. Start practicing loving one another. You know, that is one thing to pray. That is another thing, doing practical things to replace the curse with a blessing. Maybe you need to do a family gathering so that parents can bless children. This last week, I went to facilitate a meeting where the parents were blessing every child. Why? Because they recognized there was a curse of stagnation. Maybe you need to start a quarterly, weekly, monthly prayer gathering with your family. All I'm saying, today, we want to break every chain in Jesus' name. Let's break every chain.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
Whatever you are, break every chain.
There is power.
Yes, Lord.
In the name of Jesus. So there is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain. Break every chain, break every chain.
You wanna break every chain right now, wherever you are.
To break every chain,
break every chain, break every curse,
break every
bondage in the name of Jesus.
There is power.
Hey, come on now, just declare. There is power
in the name of Jesus.
Yes, Lord, there is power right now in Jesus' name. Somebody break. Somebody break every restriction, every limitation in Jesus' name.
There is power in yes, the name of Jesus.
Yes, Jesus.
To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
We are breaking every chain.
To break every chain. Break every
in
chain.
In Jesus' name.
Break every chain.
Right now. I am stretching my hands to every family right now. I am breaking every curse, any limitation, any point that maybe your family has not been able to go beyond that point. I am breaking that curse of stagnation. I am breaking the curse of barrenness. I am breaking the curse of lack of progress. I am breaking the curse of marital failure and marital delays. I am breaking the curse of poverty. I am breaking the curse of alcoholism. I am breaking the curse of diabetes, high blood pressure, arthritis, every chronic illnesses. We are breaking it now. We are breaking it now. We are breaking it now. In the name of Jesus, oh God, we break it. We break every curse. We break every curse. We break every bondage. In the name of Jesus, the bondage of foolishness. People don't go far in education. We break it now. We break it now. We break it now. In the name of Jesus. Listen to me, God's people. You shall be the head and not the tail. I break every curse that has said you shall be the tail. I break the curse of demotion. I break the curse that has said you shall be beneath and never above. I am breaking that curse now in Jesus' name. The curse of marital delay, the curse of marital failure, the curse of loss of money and debt in Jesus' name. Depression, mental illness, I break you now in Jesus' name. And so right now, anything that is preventing your success, anything that is preventing your progress in marriage, in your business excellence, I am breaking it right now. Like Jacob, today we wrestle with God. And we are saying, I cannot continue being limited, being restricted, being restrained. I cannot continue being resisted. Yes, I'm a child of God, but I recognize some negative patterns that need to be broken. And this morning, I break every negative pattern over your life in Jesus' name. And so I invite you this week, recognize those negative patterns. Repent of those negative patterns on behalf of your ancestors. Number three, release your family from them. And lastly, replace them in Jesus' name. Father, I bless your people now. By the power of my tongue, I break every curse over that family that is watching me right now. I break the curse over that man, over that woman that is looking at me right now. I break every curse, every spiritual bondage in Jesus' name. And right now, by the anointing of God over my life, I release you to succeed. I release you to progress. I release your star to shine. I release you to get children. I release you for marriage. I release you right now to get jobs. I release you now. I release you now. I pray that by this time next Sunday, you'll have a testimony. You're going to see the Spirit of the Lord move in your life, breaking every curse. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen.
Break every chain. Break every chain. Break every chain. Lord, break every chain. Break every chain. Break every chain.
God, we glorify your name in Jesus' name.